It's hard to still make them out. It's not just the heat that's been kind of addling my brain this past week. It's just been one of those weeks for me. Things have just kind of becoming fast and fierce, and you hardly have time to deal with one thing until another one comes along. We set a record this past week at my branch of IU Health. When I went on board with IU Health, we had 18 patients. This week we broke 45. And that's a lot of folks, which is good in a sense. I mean, we're job security. It's all right. It's all nice. It's really good. But in this past week, we lost 4 of them, 10%, which is part of what we focus on, is helping people as they come to the end of their lives and achieve a high quality of life. But this was a different thing for me. I've been to a lot of funerals, and I have been with many people when they die, but that volume and that short time, that's kind of been a thing for me. So I'm trying to get my head around that. And then, if that wasn't enough, and these two texts that Martin read a few minutes ago, and I've been scratching my head all week trying to understand those, because those are two texts that, those scripture years, let's just leave it at that. Those are complicated texts. In a way, they're kind of caught up with this whole idea of grief, and pain, and change, and human mortality. Most of us, when we open our Bibles, they don't fall open to these texts. And there's probably a reason for that. It's because these texts are not the kind of thing that make us feel particularly good. But that still means the things we have to deal with, we have to come to terms with. The first one, that's probably the easiest of the two. That's Jeremiah talking. Martin was right. Jeremiah was followed around by a scribe, a guy by the name of Baruch. And he had to be followed around by a scribe named Baruch, because Jeremiah was a hot, wet mess. Sometimes he's called the weeping prophet. Sometimes he's called the emoting or the empathic prophet. One Old Testament scholar once described Jeremiah as he was a man who was completely immersed into the feelings of God. So when Jeremiah spoke, he didn't speak about what he thought. He spoke about what God felt. So when Jeremiah says, "Oh, that my eyes were famished. Oh, that my people are sick and there is no healing for them. Is there not balm for their wound in Gilead? Oh, God has forsaken them." He is not just talking about what he sees. He is talking about what God literally feels when God looks at his people. Now, think about that for a minute, if you would. Think about your worst day, okay? The worst day of your life, right? It was bad, wasn't it? Remember how the badness was both deep and wide? Something happened that was bad, and that just kind of colored everything that happened after it. I don't know what your badness is. You know, maybe it was at a doctor's office. Maybe you were in an accident. Maybe you got a pink slip. Somebody you love stopped loving you, I don't know. But just remember how that felt, okay? What Jeremiah is describing is that God felt what you felt on your worst day. Everything that you felt, that tumult of emotions, that despair, that pain, that frustration, everything at once. That was not something God read about in a newspaper or watched on MSNBC or Fox. It's not something you got the word about on social media. All those prayer requests that we shared this morning, God feels more intensely about those things than we do. Scripture says he knows when a sparrow falls from a tree. He knows the numbers of hairs on our head. He does not know this intellectually. In the Bible, when it speaks about knowledge, it thinks of relationship. What you feel, I feel. What they feel, I feel. We are not separated in little neat Tupperware containers where you're over here and I'm over there. We are all connected. And God felt that on your worst day. more intensely than you did. And he thought to himself, oh, that I had fountains for my eyes, and oh, that I had some balm in Gilead that I could apply to this wound. Oh, that I could make my child, my people, well again. That's what Jeremiah is describing. The intensity of what God gets out of this connection with us. Now take this even a step further. Your bad, your worst day, right? God feels that every day for somebody. And God doesn't just feel it for somebody. God feels that for everybody. What must it have been like to be God on 9/11? To feel a whole nation breathe. What must it have been like in 1968 when Dr. King was shot and all the cities rioted? To feel all of that, that rage, that frustration, that anger, to feel it all at once, from every quarter. What must it have felt like for God when General Motors left Wabash, or not General Motors, General Tire? All those families, all that worry, all that anxiety. And here's this mainstay that has been there since Dr. Ford's day, practically. And it's gone, and everybody's in emotional free fall. God didn't just feel that for one person. God felt that for all of us. Oh, that my eyes were tears. Oh, that there was some medicine, some balm that I could put upon this. Oh, that I could make this well. You start thinking about it, it really makes me wonder, how does God feel about Syria? How does he feel Syria? How does he feel Ferguson or Charlotte? How does he feel the anxiety that a lot of us feel as we come down to the wire of the general election? For God, these are not just little things that come across the ticker tape. They are a part of existence, and because God is the ground of all being, God feels them too. He knows them in a more pure and deeper and wider way than we can. If you ever got the notion that God is some bearded old man who sits on a throne all day and looks majestic, then you don't know the God of the Bible, because the God of the Bible is connected to everything. Your back pain is his back pain. Your divorce regrets, your worries about your aging mother, your anxieties about who will fill this pulpit eventually, all that is part and parcel of God. And Jeremiah felt that, which begs the question, why don't we? We're supposed to be God's people, right? We're supposed to be chips off the old block. We're supposed to become like God. That's why we baptized you. You, like Jeremiah, were completely immersed into something. And it wasn't just water from the river. He was into the Spirit of God. So why don't we feel this way? There's some basic reasons for that, I think. One is it would drive most of us crazy. We would be mad. There is not enough tassel in the world to calm us down. We keep our sanity in large part by not feeling things and by putting things at arm's distance. If I felt everything that God felt about Syria, they'd lock me up. If you felt everything that God felt on 9/11, you'd be in a rubber room right now. We survive to a certain extent by not feeling. We callous over our hearts to survive. But God says, I want you to do more than survive. I want you to be like me. So I'm going to work on you and through you and around you so that you don't just know me from a book or what some guy in a sweaty black dress talks about or what they do in the church, but so you will know reality in the same way that I do. I want you to say, oh, that my eyes were fountains. Oh, that I found some balm that I could apply to this world's hurts, that I could bind up those existential things. Oh, that I could do something with what I feel. God is basically saying to all of us, I'm going to make you a little mad. I'm going to drive you a little crazy. Because by making you like me, you will feel what I feel. How do you feel about that? Some of us are thinking, I'm there. I've been a little crazy for a long time. Yeah, no problem. No problem. Come over to my house. We're a local distributor of crazy. Hey, yeah, we're having a special this week. I'd give it away if I could. Yeah. But think about that. Most of us don't want that. We don't want crazy. We don't want madness. I mean, think about the way we talk about life. Crazy. Those people. Those people are the crazy people. Not these people. Those three. Those people. It's the black sheep in my family that's the source of all this. Not me. It's that house down the street with the pit bulls. That's where the craziness comes from. It doesn't come from this house. It's the church across the street. You listening, Jonathan? Yeah, it's you. It's not us, okay? We don't want the crazy. Why don't we want the crazy? Two reasons. Crazy hurts. To feel deeply and intensely hurts. And also, crazy has a way of knocking the props out from on our notion that we're in control of things, which we all know we never were. But as long as we act like we're not crazy, then we think we can somehow pass ourselves off as being in control. God says, I don't care about your control desires. I don't care if it hurts. I just care. Oh, that my eyes were fountains. Oh, that I had a balm from Gilead. Oh, that you would feel what I feel. That's where I'm coming from, God says. So, if you're going to be loved by me, you're going to be a little crazy. You're going to do nutty things like turn the other cheek and give your cloak away and pray for those who use you and treat you badly. You're going to bare your neck to the axe. You're going to forgive those who do things to you that are awful. You're going to go crazy. You're going to be mad. You're going to be mocked. I want to think about that for a minute. All the saints have been thought of as nuts. Yeah, we light candles at their feet. We wear their medals and we talk about them. But in their day and in their time, they did nutty things. Brendan the Navigator tried to sail to heaven. Patrick, all by himself, went back to the people who enslaved him. Mother Teresa, this little woman who has now officially become a saint by say of the Holy Father, sought out lepers and people that you and I would not go next to without serious infection control, put her life at risk because she was crazy with God. Joan of Arc burned with the craziness of God. Thomas More lost his head because he was crazy enough to love God more than the desires of Henry VIII. And we have our own saints here in Wabash. The people we look up to as faith heroes, they were not the usual sort of people. They were somewhat mad. They were somewhat crazy. My point is simply, this is normal. This is the way it's supposed to be. Then there's that second text. Now, that second text scared me so much that Wednesday passed, I actually brought this text up before the elders. I don't know what to do with this text. I mean, did you listen to the text while Mark around? It's a weird text. This is not a gospel text that you hear very often. Jesus tells this story. He said there's this boss, right? And he finds out that he's got a manager, and the manager has got his hand in the till. So he says, I'm going to cut this guy loose. And what does the guy with his hand in the till do? He puts his other hand in. And he starts pulling out all the boss's money. And he starts giving it away. He calls in all the accounts receivable. He says, Doc, you owe $50? Not anymore. Now you only owe $25. Medina, you owe $10. From now on, you owe $250. Kisner, you owe $1 million, but I'll settle for $1.99. Okay? That's what he does. And the boss finds out about it, and he doesn't sack him. He doesn't take him to common pleas court. He doesn't take him to people's court or Judge Judy or anything like that. He says, attaboy. You're my man. Now, why would he do that? The guy's as crooked as crooked can be. The only explanation I can understand is because this guy, this crooked guy, felt what the boss felt. He understood the boss as not just the guy down the hall with the bigger office and the brass plate on his door. He understood that he had to feel what the boss felt, and he had to translate what the boss felt into other people's lives as well. Think about that. He's crazy. He's mad, this crooked manager. And yet, that's the kind of madness, that's the kind of craziness that the gospel holds up. It says, not only does God feel what you feel as you worry about your children, or you worry about yourself, or you worry about this world, but God wants you to feel, to know what other people are feeling and act upon it, and to put yourself at risk in the process. Who do you know that's hurting right now? People in the family, right? People in your neighborhood? People sitting just behind you, just before you, just beside you? Yeah? God says, it's not enough for you just to feel what I feel. I'm not going to turn loose of you until you feel what they feel. Until your life and theirs get so tangled up that the craziness is not just going on between your ears, it's going on between you and these other folks. But think about that for a minute. In Wabash, that means it is not enough for us to come into this beautiful, overheated room and sing God's praises. God's craziness is going to compel us to go outside of this room and to find the people who are not here, who would not even feel comfortable being here, and to feel their existence, to know life in the same way that they do. God's craziness will take us to meth labs. It will take us to grieving people. It will take us to jail. It will take us to the drunk tank. It will take us to the unemployment line. It will take us to the unwashed. It will take us to the unwell. We will have to feel what they feel. It will take us to the racist. It'll take us to the misogynist. It'll take us to the miser. It'll take us to the adulterer. It'll take us to the person who has no pretense whatsoever that I'm pretending to be good. And we will have to care about them in the same way that God cares about us. We will have to feel their life in the same way that God feels ours. And you know what people will say? Those people are nuts. Those people, Wabash Christian, they are crazy. They need to padlock that place. Instead of stained glass, they need rubber on the walls. That's what they need. But that will be a sign when we not just sit and talk about God, when we not just pray to God, when we not just reboot the old tried and true things, but when we get up off these creaking pews and leave this place and care for those people in the same way that God cares for us, that we are God's. When we have eyes that weep like fountains, when we go looking for a balm in Gilead to dress their wounds, when we put both our hands into the till and start handing out pell-mell what God has given to us, that is a sign that we are God. Those four people I lost this week, in the month I've worked with them, I never showed up. I've seen each of them at least 15 times. I knew their stories. I knew who they were. I miss them. There's craziness in my word. To love people who are soon going to die means that you will experience death yourself. To quote Raymond Chandler, to say goodbye in any form is to die a little bit. So it is with you. So it is with you. So it is with God. If you care about something other than yourself, it's going to hurt. It's going to make you look awkward. It's going to make you look silly. But ultimately, it's what enables people to see that God weeps and cares for them as well. That, it seems to me, is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. That I know is the end of this lesson.